where equality is just another euphemism for mediocrity, where participation is more highly valued than achievement, where just enough to get by is the new standard of excellence. There is a small minority of people who fight back against such apathy, who struggle daily to reach new heights. These brave few are the hope for the future, the bright shining light for the next generation. They are the ones who will lead us to the places we have never dreamed of, to the undiscovered country, to reach goals only a few can even begin to imagine. Unfortunately, none of those people could be here tonight, so kick back and relax. Prepare yourself for several hours of fun, friendship, fascinating conversation, and fabulous music. All those F's, that's an alliteration and kind of a radio trick. Speaking of radio, you're listening to the most popular radio station in the history of broadcast radio, at least among stations that originate from Chris's living room. It's Curious Times. Your host is a curious listener. Here she is, Chris.
All right. Hello, everybody. Welcome to Curious Times. It's Sunday, May 6th already. I think spring's in full swing. Spring is in swing for most people, except Terry, where it's fall is what it's all about. And I always hate when I'm on the other end of that, and I'm heading into winter, and Terry's heading into summer, and I'm all, like, jealous. I'm like, I want summer. Actually, if I had it my way, it would be perpetually spring. Perpetually spring. If I was rich, I'd follow spring around the world. You know what I mean? And there you go. That's what I would do. So we have Hillary Black here tonight. It feels like it's been forever since I talked with Hillary. But on the one hand, time flies. And on the other hand, it seems to go. You know what I mean? So tomorrow we have Diana Monroe here. Melissa Bruce, the heavy metal sidekick. Our astrologer is here on Tuesday, Wednesday, Kathleen Moore. And then we got like four whole days where we got nada. And then Aaliyah Dawn is next Monday. And so on, and so on, and so on. And so ask Hillary Black. Ask Hillary Black. If you Google that, you will find Hillary Black. If you Google Hillary Black, you will find Ask Hillary. And so just Google her for crying out loud. But you can also go www.askhillaryblack.com and on Facebook, Ask Hillary Black. You get the idea. Hey, Ask Hillary Black. She's a really, what would we call it? Like a utility, what would be a good word? I'm just like making this stuff up on the fly here. A utility, like she's a versatile, like she's a utility metaphysical person. So she can, you know, she can do the psychic stuff, the mediumship. She really rocks an awesome pendulum. She rocks the pendulum, you guys. And she has most of the clairs. She's also an empath. She can do psychometry, tarot. She even does tarot. And if you really insist on getting married or something like that, I think she can even marry you. Like, I don't mean get married to you, but marry you. Officiate. She's also a life and a business coach. You name it. Except she does not do windows. And but just about anything in the metaphysical arena, Hillary can do or know somebody who can do it probably. And so without any more delay, let's just go get Hillary with her fancy new headset. How's it going, Hillary?
Good. How are you? Thank you for having me back. I know it does feel like it's been a while, doesn't it?
Thank you for being had. I love it when people say that. Thank you for having me. Thank you for being had.
Oh, that's so funny. The connotations of words, which is what we're going to talk about today. So, right in the segue of it. I mean, you know, really it's all about power of words, everything that we really talk about, the power of words and the subconscious mind and the beliefs and the thoughts. And I looked at my calendar of what we were going to talk about, and I actually put it in my calendar. I was so proud of myself. And it was about relationships and fear, and really more about relationships, which we'll go into. And then if we'll get to the fear, the next section as well. But it really is about what we think is what we attract, you know, and the power of thoughts. And I was talking to somebody the other day about relationships and marriage and, you know, just kind of where society is going. And, you know, back in the day, and I would say in the '80s, I'm 51, you know, some women, I can't speak for all women, but someone would say they'd want a gentleman or a man who would make more income because, you know, when you want to get married and have children and if you take some time off. But they were saying to me that, you know, the generation now is about how it's equal. And so if somebody makes 30,000, if it's a woman makes 30,000, then they're going to get a man who makes 30. And I had another friend of mine. He's a gentleman and he's out there dating and he's, I don't know, makes 90,000 or whatever he makes. But the point is that he found that these women want 6 foot men and they want men who make 100 or women who make 120 or men who make 120,000 because that's what they make. So yeah. It is kind of going in that trajectory, so to speak. And marriage is, you know, I mean, I think the divorce rate is now 55%. I mean, I don't even know. So the way relationships used to look like and the way they look like now are completely different. So I can see how a lot of people who come to me and the coaching aspect, you know, there's so many different things that people, you know, personally want to work on, right? When they come to me as a coach, and yes, I'm an intuitive and I do blend it. I mean, some people are like, I just want to have a new career. You know, I just lost my job and I want to attain a new job, but I also want to have a business on the side, or I want to do this, or I want to have a new house, or I want to get married, or I want to release these patterns in my life, because we're all driven by patterns. So we think, okay, we're going to leave this relationship and we're going to get to the next one. So, you know, that solves the problem, but then we don't look at ourselves because truly the problems come within us. Because my spiritual teacher had said to me, Hillary, what are your belief systems? This was quite some time ago. And I'm like, I can't articulate that. I don't know. I mean, if you want me to put it on paper right now, I couldn't tell you. And she goes, well, I can tell you. Go look and see what's on your outside, what you're attracting. Show, see everything that's around you is your belief systems, because that's a vibrational, that's the Esther Hicks thing. We're vibrationally attracting what we think. And so that's one of the things that I wanted to talk about, fear. I mean, we'll touch on it, but certainly we'll get into it in the next month. I want to talk about that next time. I think it's June 4th, I think, is which I'll be our next time that we meet. But so, you know, we're a lot. Yep, it's June 3rd, actually. We're driven by fear. Now, so when I'm talking to a client, they'll say, well, doesn't everyone feel that way? And I'm like, no, you know, because we all sit here and think the problems that we're going through, that pretty much everyone has the same problems and everyone's in the same, you know, place, where some people are like, they've mastered money, but they haven't mastered relationships. Some people have mastered relationships. They haven't mastered money. Some people have a balance of all. So this is an interesting thing. So, let me put it this way. Some people believe that you can have it all, and you can. Do you agree with that or no?
Yeah, I do. Yes, I do. Just some quick thoughts, because you know what happens is then we get all off and then I forget about what. So as to so far, I agree with you that, like, say our parents' generation and before then, and even some in our generation, have married for the wrong reasons. You know what I mean? Very many.
I agree.
And it can't sustain itself. So they can maybe hang out together for the 20 years it takes to raise the kids, and many of them didn't even make it that far. For the same reason, you know, anybody, now I understand the logic around, I just have an issue with exclusively focusing on a certain, either income, earning level of a prospective partner or an appearance, a specific appearance of a prospective, because to me, you're limiting, you're not even giving the chance for the true love, you know what I mean? Because if you eliminate, like, I only want dark-haired men, you know what I mean? Now you're
right.
Eliminating every other guy. And, but your guy might be, you know, blonde, you know?
Right.
And, so it's like when people call psychics and they say, well, what color is his hair? To me, that bothers me because they're only going to be keeping their eyes open. They're going to dismiss, if the psychic says blonde haired guy, they're going to dismiss every guy that's got dark hair that might be, you know, trying to strike up a conversation with them, because they'll be going, oh, no, it's not him. It's not him. It's not him. And so for the, and I used to have people, like I clearly remember early on in my radio show that I had a lady calling in, and she was so snobby. And like here she was, even having to move from little motel room to little motel room and all this kind of stuff, looking for work and then later looking for, and so a certain, any types of job was below her. You see what I mean? It was below her.
Right.
And like, that's not going to work. And then I had another one that I was called, and the psychic had said to them, this guy works with his hands. He might be a mechanic. Oh, I would never date somebody that. You know what I mean? And I'm all like, what are you bringing to the whole thing besides being a snobby bitch? You know what I mean? And so like, I don't like it when anybody, any single person, like, eliminates whole groups of people based on a certain thing, characteristic or thing. You know what I mean? And, but anyway, that's just me.
No, well, I understand. I mean, they're shorting themselves for sure. I mean, but there are some people that do know themselves. I agree with you. They're shorting themselves. I mean, I would tell people when they're writing out their intention statement of what they want to bring in, you know, don't necessarily say it has to be 6 foot, you know, dark hair. You know, I would certainly put chemistry on there, and I would put physical attraction. I mean, one of the things that you did say is, what are you bringing to the table? Everything that you put on that list that you're asking for, whoever your significant partner is that you're looking for, you know, life partner or just happens to be in the moment, you have to have the characteristics or the qualities that you're asking to bring in. But at the same time, I will say that I do know some people that they're very clear on what kind of lifestyle they want to have.
Yeah.
And, you know,
well,
and
that's exactly good. That's fair. You know, plus listen, it's also to say that, you know, like you would think that, in many cases, let's take an income level, right? That, you know, that some of your interests would be the similar or the same anyways then. You know what I mean? Even if that's like socially or whatever, but it's not a guaranteed. And it does, like, the other good thing about that is that it eliminates, because also what had happened is that the low income female, for example, becomes almost enslaved then to the rich dude. And if he happens to be an abusive guy, then essentially they're going to allow themselves to be in a potentially abusive situation for finance. They're trading that off for financial security. And that's right. Not healthy. You know what I mean?
I agree. And so if she has that mental mindset that possibility could happen, and then that's what she could attract. But, you know, if she has the mindset, she's going to bring in a wonderful person that's going to accept her no matter what her, you know, I don't want to say disposition, because, I mean, she, you know, obviously is contributing to society and making money, you know, sort of thing, whatever the income level is, that if there's a disparaging difference on the income level, that she's going to bring someone in who loves her, that's not going to care about the income level. The fact that she's, you know, if she's in her purpose, if she's transparent, if she's honest, she's respectful. I mean, they have qualities where they're vibrationally matching in a sense.
Yeah.
But I agree with you that, you know, someone could put themselves in a situation where you know, that income level is a difference, and he's coming into a place of being controlling or being this or being that, and she has no way of getting out. That's not a great place to be.
Well, and similarly, you know, in that same generation was the other bad thing that would happen, which would be that people would marry with no intention of love or anything like this. And it was like to you know, wind up just getting a divorce and getting a big divorce settlement, getting their hands on somebody else's money. And so that's also another thing that, you know, you can somewhat minimize and eliminate when you're shopping within your own
own income bracket. I mean, and that makes sense. And maybe that's why people are coming, because, you know, it doesn't matter if it's men making more money than women. Oh, there's a lot of women now making more money than men, you know, kind of thing. And I think maybe that's why people are wanting the same income bracket. So then that way you come in, you're thinking that person is going to obviously, you know, they're marrying that person for love. They're not marrying for money because they're equal in a sense. But what happens to those people who aren't, there's an income bracket that there's a difference, right? But it's all about the belief system of what you're attracting, you know, because some people don't believe that they can have it all and then they don't. So what it is it's a self-fulfilling prophecy that we get into this loop. I call it a loop, and we get in the self-fulfilling prophecy. We believe this, we can't have it all. We have to make a decision between a career. We have to make a decision between a relationship. And so then therefore everything that they believe shows up, and then that's confirmation. See, once again, I'm right. See, once again, I'm right. And then it just gets cemented even more and more. So when you go in there and releasing the beliefs, the pattern of this belief system, because our beliefs is what drives our values, and our values are really what drive us. So we go in there and we look at a seed, and a seed is obviously, it could have been planted, you know, years ago, right? And people think that it's going to, you know, overnight with the like, flip a finger that we can release it. It doesn't necessarily work that way. Now, can we obviously make that internal shift and change within ourselves and belief? Absolutely. I have seen incredible sessions where I go in there and talk. I really talk to the little boy, the little girl, the internal self, the subconscious, whatever you want to call it, the heart. And as we go in there and address the fears, I've had a session with someone that is, it was incredible. The difference it made in their income that day, it was just surprising. It was really profound. But again, it's the manifestation of it. So you manifest something. So you're holding that thought to create it and bring it to you. But then again, like someone who wins $1 million, then a couple of years later, they're broke. It's also holding that vibration. It's the same thing in a relationship in some way, because one of the go ahead.
It's like, yeah, if you go into it with that, energy is very important. And so if you're sensitive to energy, then you should be a little bit, you should be in good stead for this. But is like everything should match balance, right? And so, otherwise it won't be sustained. And so, I hate the vibration you're at or whatever, because it suggests someone's at a higher, you know, than somebody's
right.
at a lower.
I understand. I mean,
if you're on the same wavelength, you know what I mean? If you're on the same wavelength, then, chances are that things are going to, you know, have a better shot at working out. Than somebody, like, I had a guy say to me a long time ago, like, well, you should wear dresses, you know, and you'd attract guys easier. And I'm like, well, but then I'm attracting guys that are attracted to me because I'm wearing a dress, and I don't like
right.
to wear dresses.
Right.
And so I'm either going to be stuck wearing dresses for the rest of my life and doing something I don't like to do, or, you know, and so in that way, like, I'm not looking to attract somebody. It's like women that go, you know, to sports events that they hate, right, to find a guy. And then they get pissed off because their husband's unavailable to them all weekend because they're at the football all the time or whatever. Well, like, what did you do? You went
right.
specifically to find a guy at football because you wanted to go to a place where guys were going to be hanging out. And so, you know, if you don't like football, don't go shopping at the football stadium for your dude.
Right. That's really important. And that's why they're, you know, the statement of, you know, live your life and live the best life ever. If you're truly in love with yourself and love with your life, you will really, attract the right person, because it's kind of like a magnet, right? So it all starts within us. and it's coming back to the place of self. And, you know, people are like, well, it can't really be that easy. Well, one thing, it's not that easy. I mean, yes and no, it can be that easy. But at the same time, it's changing that years of belief system, right? Because you got to activate that seed. You got to acknowledge it, right? You got to own, you got to identify it and own it. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, like I've said to a lot of callers over the years, like, you see, it's that you're putting your focus on the wrong thing. And so then, like, if you're always panicked, like, people can pick up on energy. And so if you're panicked about finding a guy, like, how many times do I hear people, and they go, oh, I just broke up with my boyfriend. When's my next boyfriend? Right? Holy crap. Like, it's like your only identity is, like, if you have a boyfriend. And so how about try this? Go on with your life. Go and find recreational activities that make you feel good, that you enjoy doing. And then the thing is that happens is that while you're out and about in the world, whether this is at work, at the grocery store, at the bank, walking in the park, or wherever you are engaging in your recreational activity that you like so much, the energy that you're putting out is like, can't be, like, it's not something that words can describe, but it's something that can be felt by other people. And I've often used the example, like, have you ever been out and in a grocery store or elsewhere, house party or anything like this, and there's just, like, one person that you notice, and there's just, like, something about them. It's not their looks, it's not, like, but it's just, like, you, and you just feel like you want to go and talk to them. It's because their energy that they're putting out is very good. And so, and people, and that, but if you're panicked and, or negative and expecting bad things, and then, like, I say to people, like, don't go to job interviews. And when they ask you, you know, like, why should you work for us? So, well, I haven't had a job in a long time. You know, being all depressed, right? Go in there with high energy and a smile and excitement, and because this is all going to transfer energy, and it's going to transfer energy to the people that are interviewing you. And it's not unlike how you would find good friends and how you would find a partner. It's like the energy that you're putting out. And so if you're enjoying what you're doing, the chances are greatly increased that just like innately, the energetic patterns that you're going to be like sending out into the world are going to be those which would attract other people that are attracted to good energy like that.
Right. Right. And you know what one person likes and the other person may not, right? I say what you like, your neighbor may not care for. What your neighbor care for, you may not like, but you don't really need anyone's approval but yours. Right. And that's really getting to know yourself, because if we really know ourselves, then, you know, you will have an opportunity to really attract the right person. Now, we change as people as we grow, and that's one thing when we get in relationships, we've either outgrown our spouse or something, or we've gone in a different direction than our spouse, you know, like Star Wars, right? You know, and are you a Star Wars fan?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, and I have to ask that, because, you know, I think people, oh, they've seen this movie. And, you know, how can you not see Star Wars? A lot of people have not seen Star Wars, or Star Trek for that matter. But, yeah, needless to say, the Star Wars where she's like, Anakin, you're breaking my heart, because, you know, he's going a different path and she can go. I mean, here they have this great love affair. And then he went into fear and went into the dark side, right? Because he had this premonition, being the psychic Jedi that he was, that he saw her dying. And he, I don't remember if he had seen it in childbirth, but he knew that she was going to die. So he was going to do whatever it took, you know, and to save his great love. But by doing whatever it took to save his great love, he pushed her away, and then she still died. He couldn't, you know, there's some things we can't shift out. We just can't. There's certain things we can say, hey, thanks for that, in the sense of when we do a reading, we're a purveyor of information. We're just giving you that information. You know, that person who's getting the information is the person who's the recipient of the reading really has free will. And I tell people, even things are fated to be, I see interactions with people where I can see they're coming into each other's lives, and it's fated for them to meet. Free will always trump fate. Always. So people, you know, when people say, well, if we're going to be together, no matter what, we're going to be together. And I don't know about that. I've seen too many things of free will where, yeah, they were supposed to get together. It's in the cards. I see it. It's in the stars. It's here and it's not happening. It's not happening. Now, do I believe in fate? Absolutely. I read a story online about this couple that, they had known each other in kindergarten. They were in each other kindergarten. There was a picture and they had gone on with their lives. And I don't know, she had some boyfriends and he actually had a fiance that passed away and he moved back to the area and they got reintroduced to each other. And he said, there's something about you. I don't know what it was. And it was just a spark between them. And he's like, I feel like I've known you my whole life. And when they were, by the way, 4 and 5, so what happened was, is they were together for a year and a half, I think. They got engaged. They went through some of their pictures, and he pulled out his kindergarten picture, and she goes, oh, my God, that's my kindergarten picture. They were in the same kindergarten class, and they wrote a little letter to each other that they loved each other and they wanted to marry each other. And, like, 30, 35 years later, they got together. Now, yes, that's fate. Definitely no doubt. But they had free will to get together. They still were, they came back to an interaction with each other. You know, they were 5 and 4 or 5 and 5. And, you know, at 5 years old, declared to each other that they loved each other and wanted to get married, went off, had their own lives and went and got together with other people. But they did come back. They had an opportunity, a serendipitous moment of coming back together, and they made a choice to be together. They could have chose not to be together. And that would have been free will, obviously, you know, kicking that. But they chose to get together. So again, we are the master of our universe. We're the master of our world. And so people will come to me and say, well, I want this person. I understand it. I've been there too. I want this person. I'd like to be together with this person, but we can't change anyone but ourselves. And we can't make anyone like us or feel good about us. I mean, the only thing we can do is change our energy. So we have to look at our energy in that moment and say, okay, what kind of energy was I exuding? Was I exuding positive energy? Was I exuding excitement? Or was I in resentment? Or was I in fear? Or, you know, those kind of things. And that's the only thing that we can do is a temperature check within ourselves about what we're emitting out there. You know, because a lot of times we put the blame on other people. You did this and you did that. And you said this to me. And even though when we have misunderstandings sometimes, we're trying to, things get difficult, you know, when those misunderstandings happen. And then, you know, people go into those emotions and things could shift by just having a positive set of emotions instead of releasing the anger, releasing the fear, releasing the bitterness and, you know, and letting it go and not holding on to it. And that's what happens in our marriages. You know, they always say, don't go to bed angry, right? Have gratitude when you get up. I mean, this is stuff, even if it's not relationship based, it's, you know, pretty much in our lives.
I mean, I've said, you know, I agree to a certain extent, like, I read a statement one time, which is, you know, something like a pessimist might wind up being right, but an optimist has a better time getting there. You know what I mean?
Right.
And the other thing is like, yeah, if you are a negative all the time about everything, negative, then really, like, who wants to be around you, you know? And so you gotta keep that in mind too. And, again, that translates into the energy that you send out. And what, like, you wanna be the kind of person that people wanna be around. And then the more people that wanna be around you, the higher the chances are that you're gonna, you know, have a better selection. You know what I mean?
Well, that's true. That's true.
Around you to choose from. And like a magnet, I think you said earlier on in the conversation. And so, but yeah, like being like, again, like being positive is, you know, if you find yourself going, I could never, you know, then, you know, that might be a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Mm-hmm. It's power of words. So, you know, I always sometimes I reference to the power of your subconscious mind by Joseph Murphy. And in this section of your subconscious mind and marital problems, but it's not necessarily about marital problems. It's about marital problems, but it's also attracting the right person, right? And I'll read things at the end, but one of the things they talked about is how this woman had been married 3 times, right? Now, in a sense, you know, people do believe in karma. Some people do, right? I do. And I was on the fence for a while. But the thing, do you believe in karma as well?
It depends on what you call karma. You know what I mean?
Lessons lessons from past lives and stuff that needed to be learned and that sort of thing.
My idea is that we, our higher self, we choose everything. And
yes.
So it's not as simple as, oh, if my house burns down this lifetime, it must be that I burned someone else's house down last lifetime. Like, that's not quite it for me.
Right. And I understand that. I agree.
I feel more like along the lines of karma. The funny story I always tell, and I just told it the other day, is, you know, I was in a pub one time with all my friends playing darts, right? After work. And, so I was noticing as I was walking back, towards our table, the way this one was set up is that there was like a pool table, and right behind the pool table was one of the tables that some of our people were sitting at. And I noticed that a guy had bent over to start to take his shot, and you know how they draw the pool cue backwards, eh? And so I started laughing and saying to the person, you're about to get your head whacked by a pool cue. And just as I said that, I walked smack into the TV that's mounted on the wall.
Oh,
and I walked.
No.
I laughed at that moment. I laughed my ass off, and I go, that's what you call instant karma. You know what I mean? And
yeah.
So I'm more about it being that way than it being a lifetime to lifetime lesson thing, is because I believe that it's about being a human being and coming in all this. And if we choose to, those of us that agree and believe that we have the right to choose to come back, and we, probably many and most of us have had many more than one lifetime, that we're kind of choosing the major events of our life. And I feel that there's, little, like the stuff you call free will is like all the little inconsequential stuff in the middle, in between. So if I must get to Calgary, and I have to get to Calgary, and my destination is Calgary by a certain time, then the route that I take to get to Calgary doesn't matter. You know what
right.
I mean? So that's my free will. If I choose to go left here and right there and, you know, stop or don't stop, and then those are all of the things that don't affect the outcome of that necessity that I be in Calgary at a particular time. And, but so like on a grander level, I feel like that our lifetimes is not about lessons per se, as we thrive, we strive to, have experiences. So, how can I know what it's like to be stolen from unless I set myself up to get stolen from? You know what I mean? How
right.
can I know what it feels like to, you know, hurt my knee unless I fall and hurt and skin my knee? How can I know what it's like to be in love unless I go and be in love? How can I know what it's like to be heartbroken unless I have something in that lifetime that's going to set me up to cause heartbreak? And so I always think that the people that the protagonists in our life, they're the people that are serving us. They're doing us that great favor.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So like some people, they think about, well, this person was bad to me this lifetime, they're going to have a bad lifetime next time. No, this person was bad to me this lifetime, theoretically, in my way of thinking, is because I had a soul contract with them and they honored their contract. So why should there be any punishment, including in their life review, if their actions in that lifetime were in accordance with a soul contract that they had, and all they did was they honored their contract? Why would there be punishment for that? And so I'm more about thinking that we choose, and some of us choose harder lives, or maybe
mm-hmm.
the older souls choose the harder paths. You know what I mean? I don't know the answers to all of those things, but I'm fairly convinced, like, how can we say I love when people go like, yes, I think we pick our parents, and yes, I think we do. And then like disagree that, you know what I mean? That anything bad that, like, there, no good story, book, or movie is any good without a protagonist, right?
Right. Well, no, I agree with you. I agree.
An antagonist. We need to have a protagonist and an antagonist in a story, yes?
Yes.
And so if I play my part in the play and you play your part in the play and the play winds up being a very good play, why does somebody have to be punished because they played the antagonist and the other one gets to get patted on the back because they played the protagonist? You know what I mean?
Well, yes. I mean, in a sense, I don't want to diminish anyone's tragedy, whatever that tragedy has gone through. The thing is, it's how you come out of that tragedy and the pearls of wisdom that you bring to the table through that. And I do agree. I mean, you know, it's kind of like we're souls up there. Earth is our classroom. We say, let's learn this lesson. Let's learn this or let's learn that. And then we come down here, as I've said before, and sometimes we say, yeah, I want to drop the class. And they're like, no, because you need it for level 2 and 3. You know, take it. If you need to repeat the class, you will. And that's part of our patterns, is repeating the class all over again. We repeat, we repeat, we repeat, and we want to break it.
Even there, now again, like even there, and I can't say that I'm right or you're right or anyone's wrong, and maybe we're all right and nobody's wrong, right? But here's my thinking. Every lifetime that there, you know, in a lifetime we have a bucket list, right?
Right.
I want to go to, you know, I want to go to New Zealand, or I want to go to Greenland, or I want to go skydiving, whatever, you know? And so these are all our bucket lists. So, like, how about if our soul has a great big bucket list, right? And so now I'm over there on the other side contemplating coming back for another experience, and I'm going, well, what should this experience, what's going to go on my bucket list? It's not unlike, I need to go out today and do some errands, and I need to get some groceries, I need to stop at the bank, I need to go pick up, drop my shoes off at the shoe repair place, I need to, whatever, right? I need to pick up some garden hose, okay, all these things are on my list. Now, if I wind up, and through whatever reason, either, oh, I forgot to stop and get that, or I went to that store, but they didn't happen to have garden hose. Guess what? That just goes on to the next list. It's not a failure. It's not, you know, it's not something that, like, because when we use the terminology of you have to repeat it because you didn't do it right, like, that brings to me, like, a negative thinking on it. And it's to say, I feel like that everybody accomplishes what they did plan and come to do. And if there's things that got, you know, messed up, who knows how come, and they didn't wind up being, like, they're still on the list. You can choose the next time, but it's you choosing. Like, have you ever heard somebody, Hillary, saying, oh, well, somebody that committed suicide, they don't get to go to heaven. They have to, like, be reborn instantly and redo everything all over again. It's like this great punishment because somebody committed suicide, and that the thought that they now have to go back and start at ground zero and redo that life. And to me, that's not the way it works. It's like, because our higher self is the one that's choosing what we're coming to do. And there's no failure, and there's no passing, and there's no punishment, and you must redo, and you must, you know, all these things in our mind as human beings suggest that there's been failure, right? You did something wrong. Now you have to go back and redo it again. And I don't think that's the way it is at all. And nobody makes us do anything. Now, if our higher self says, well, I could have done that better, you know, then that's the higher self doing that. And then they put that back on the list. But it's the way so many people talk about it is like that it's mandated upon them. And they must redo that. I don't think anything, God or any other being, at all has any say over A, whether I come back to another life, and B, if I do come back to another life, what that life is going to entail. I believe that that's my higher self, my spirit, my soul, whatever you want to call it, who is making those choices exclusively. Nobody dictates to nobody. You know what I mean? And that's just my thought. It doesn't mean I'm right, but that makes sense to me.
No, yeah, we all have our own belief system, and that makes sense as well. And I've always, you know, I've always said that I believe that God is all knowing, universe is all knowing. I say God, and we have free will. He knows everything we're going to do before we do it, but he gives us free will to choose what we want. And, you know, I do believe that, you know, if someone does, you know, they check out, as I call it, so to speak, physically check out, go to the other side, whether it's early or late or whatever the time frame, meaning before I believe that we all have more than one exit, so to speak. I believe sometimes we have five windows, right? And so I feel like sometimes we have one, because, you know, they've talked about this where I don't know, you know, again, I don't know, I don't quote me on it, but I think in Columbine, in Littleton, Colorado, and I lived in Denver, Colorado. And, I think one of the girls that had passed and was shot wrote a letter to her parents that she knew she was going to die. Mm-hmm. And she had said goodbye to them. And she said God was coming to take her, and she didn't want to go. But God or the angels, like, I don't know which one it was, had come and said to her, that she had a dream, and they told her she was dying, and she said, I don't want to die. I don't want to go. And they said, it's your time. You have to come. And so there are times, you know, when they found this letter afterwards, and, she had kind of prepared, I don't know what she had done to set everything up, because she didn't know how she was going to go. She didn't know, you know, when it was going to happen. She just knew it was soon, and that she had this dream. And then she was one of the people that had gotten shot. I don't remember her name. There's, you know, where they have a monument for them. It's at a park, you know, close to that high school. And I happen to live, I don't know, 20 minutes from it or something like that. But the point of the matter is that there's times where we have windows, and some people choose to take them a little bit earlier, so to speak. So I don't know. I could see where you're saying, you know, some people have said you have to be rebirthed and go through the whole thing all over again. I believe that you finish your work on the other side. Whatever you work here to do, you know, again, you're saying experiences. You're still going to have those lessons. You're still going to have other things that you do on the other side. I mean, even though I've talked to people who've passed over, I mean, in a sense, and they've come back and had those near death experiences. And I've asked a couple people what they are. And one person told me there was no human form at all. You were just a ball of light, and, you know, the energy was pure, and it was just love. Another person explained to me that he saw angels, and that they were in line, and there, you know, there were aliens there as well. And I believe that there's other human life forms besides, us humans. I believe that there are aliens, but everyone has their own belief about that. And they were all in a line of the pearly gate of the life review, as you say, you know, and they had to explain why they did what they did and the reasoning. And he thought he was in the wrong line, because he said there was an alien being right next to him that was a warrior, and this guy had not gone to war, and he's thinking he's in the wrong place, and the angels had taken him to all these different universes. And then he came back and he said there was three doors. And I mean, this man was like, I don't know, over 6 feet, really big man. He was a hospital administrator. This is years ago when I talked to him, about 22 years ago, when my father was in a coma. And I said, I have to know. He starts breaking down, he starts crying, and he said he had picked one of the doors, and the door that he went in, happened to be the symbol of the MRI room where he'd woken up. And, I think they were testing him for spinal meningitis, but the angels had taken him to the ball field where they were supposed to go visit on their vacation. And that's where the doors, and then, you know, he didn't say much after that, but needless to say, it's, you know, let's go back to the, cause I segued, and I apologize on that, in the sense of failure. Okay. So, sometimes out of that tragedy, or out of something that someone thinks is a failure, we have a success, right? And it's so in the patterns and repeating patterns, people, if they want to stay at a certain place and they're happy there, there's nothing wrong with that. There's no good or bad in that. If they're happy where they're at and they're satisfied and a certain type of job of what they want and a certain kind of income, if that's the type of income they're okay with, and they don't want to have the high life, or they don't want to have a certain high income, or they're just comfortable where they're at and they don't want to have any more growth, or they don't want to have, you know, not saying that they aren't growing as people, but they're comfortable where they're at in their box, in their container. That's okay too. Right. Mm-hmm. But at the same place, going to the next place is that if people want to grow, and that's what happens. I talked to one of my, I haven't talked to her in a while. You've actually had her on the show. I forget her name. What is her name? I see her face. Well, she's a marriage family therapist.
Dr. Ida?
Yeah, Dr. Ida Green and I were talking about this. And she's, you know, she's a marriage family therapist. She is a nurse. She is a psychic. She's got her PhD, I believe. Don't quote me on that. And the thing is that, I mean, this woman is phenomenal, right? And she and I were talking and she said one of the things that she noticed is that when people are in marriages, one partner will grow and in just relationships in itself, one partner will grow and then they're waiting for the other partner to grow and the other partner may grow and then they go up and down. And so it's kind of like a seesaw ladder, right? Kind of thing. But sometimes people just don't want to wait for the other person to grow or they go in a different direction. So, yeah. You know, we all have to intuitively, not intuitively, but we all want to grow as beings individually, and then we're growing together on the same path, right? But some people are stuck at the place of where they're like, I'm tapped out. I don't want to grow anymore. And there's nothing wrong with that. Again, like you said, it's all experiences. But at the same time, that's why we have to have the clarity of who are we and what is it that we want. So sometimes these marriages, you know, I've been married twice. I had a 20-year marriage and I had a 3-year marriage prior to that. And the thing is that, you know, when we get married young, some people have been married when they were 15 years old and they've stayed with their partner for 60 years and they died at 75. You know, some people,
but it doesn't mean that they were happier than you and all that.
Well, that's true.
Like, people shouldn't be measuring anybody else's success. And in my opinion, we shouldn't necessarily be measuring our own, unless we have this urging from within, which is perhaps our higher self saying, okay, it's time to go now, time to go now, time to go get that thing done or time. But I want to, like, there's so much there. I want to quickly say is like that I've commented before on other shows, which is that this whole, you could have 100 people in a room that have had a near death or a life after death experience. You know what I mean? And then
right.
Come back. And they will all share a different kind, and some might have similar, but there will be radically different experiences there, right? And so my only, so either, what, are they all making it up, or is there blah, 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 who's right, who's wrong, or are they all right, and that is what their experience was, and that is it possible that the transition experience that we have is something that we have in our subconscious beliefs, like it's in our own belief system. So if somebody feels because they've been brought up, like, let's say under a Catholic religion or something, and they've been pounded with the sinners are going to go to hell or this or that, then there's those people that are going to report going through these dark tunnels with googly goblins, like moaning and groaning and reaching out from the walls at them and trying to grab them. And it's terrifying. And it's dark and it's scary and it's awful. And then other people, like I know one friend of mine, she like came out into just like a green field and saw little kids playing over there and her grandfather was like a tree or something like that or whatever, you know what I mean? Blah, 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 blah. But so with so many different life after death experiences, like it has to make me wonder, like, is it something that we construct ourselves? And then quickly wanted to add, because it still sounded to me like as though like that, like I do believe that we have multiple exit points and that it's our time to go, it's our time to go. Now, it could be that, let's say that I went on that grocery shopping trip and I didn't find the garden hose. So that garden hose is outstanding. It hasn't quite been done. So maybe if an exit point comes, then I go, well, hang on, because I still think I can get that garden hose. You know what I mean? And so then I'll take the next train, so to speak, right? But
right.
However, we don't ever know how many exit points have we used.
We don't. Exactly.
It's not an exit point that us, the human being, is choosing or not choosing. And I just want to say that I strongly feel that when it relates to suicide, it's like if somebody dies of cancer, you know what I mean? Then would you think, or a car accident, or a plane crash, or a Columbine incident, or whatever? Like, would you believe? You know, like we wouldn't say that they had the wrong death. You know what I'm saying? And so I feel like that. Like if my end is coming, and one of the possible endings in my life is going to be suicide, That could be for many reasons. It doesn't mean I'm quitting or copping out or anything else. It's just another means of how to transition. And if it's happening now, we don't know how many, like, I often say, like, every experience that I have isn't about me necessarily. It could be that I'm in a soul contract to help somebody else with something, right? And so something really big could happen to me, but that wasn't maybe my, if I hate the word lesson, but it wasn't about my lesson. It was perhaps about the other person's lesson. And so sometimes through suicide, people, that affects, of course, anybody that might have known that person. And so there could be something there that's also been like the soul contract purpose to that, the way that that person exited life. And so I don't look at suicide as being any different than if somebody died from cancer or falling off a mountain and hitting their head or anything like that. I don't.
It's still a tragedy either way. However anyone, it passes away. It's a passing and it's a loss. And again, it's not diminishing the tragedy or the loss. But it's how do you come from that? And that's, again, as you said, the soul contract of having that person, lesson or, learning something from that, having, you know, coming into a place of enlightenment or coming into a place of a consciousness or coming to a place of awareness, that sort of thing. Cause again, we're all collective, right? You know, we're all, you know, one earth, kind of like this grid. Well, you know, this earth, and, you know, we're all energetically connected, as the trees are connected, as the, you know, everything is an energy vibration. Everything is energy. So we're all interconnected. Even if somebody enters, you know, leaves our lives, which is very painful sometimes, and it's heartbreaking, especially when you have someone you're in love with and they don't want to be a part of your life or that sort of thing. And it's an ending. We're still interconnected energy, even though we may never see someone again. It's still painful. But you know, I didn't understand that for some time. And I'm like, yeah, that's nice. I still want to see that person, you know? And they're like, well, you're still connected to that person. You know, we're all connected. And either, you know, we may not see him on the other side either, just because, you know, it's my father used to joke, death to his part. But when I pass and go to the other side, I'll be seeing Marilyn. He means Marilyn Monroe. He'll be going and looking up Marilyn Monroe. Kind of interesting. So and so, you know, when you go to the other side kind of thing, I mean, obviously I don't know exactly what it looks like. When I was 10 years old, I believe I was 10, I knocked myself out. I was changing my pants and tripped and hit the dresser. And I remember going down a white tunnel and they had said, it was very peaceful, very loving. And they said, turn around. And I'm like, no, I want to come. Nope, not your time. Turn around. And so it was a white light kind of thing. But let's look at the movie, Where Dreams May Come From, right? It's the same thing. And I was raised Catholic. And so here, the, you know, Robin Williams, you know, played the dad. And I believe there's two children, two boys, and they die in a car accident. And she's so depressed and, you know, in despair, right? And so she can't take it. And takes her own life. And then when she goes over, she's in this darkness, right? Underneath all these old souls, lost souls that are in the pit of hell, basically. And so, you know, Cuban Gooding Jr. says if she's down there too long, because he's in the movie as well, you know, he won't be able to get her back. And he's like, I can't lose her. You know, she's the love of my life. So on the other side, even though they're meadows and it's like a Monet painting, so to speak, where Robin Williams is with the two kids, he goes down into the pit of hell, you know, through these lost souls, and he goes and gets her and he brings her back up. And so, mind you, it's the state of mind thing that you talked about, right? It's where our...
Yeah, I mean, and that's for the same reason why I don't feel like that I'm going to wind up. I can't say that nobody else will wind up there, because I guess that perhaps the crossing over experience will be as unique as each of our lifetimes has been. But I don't foresee myself being waiting in line at the pearly gates for God's approval of my past life. I feel, again, like that it's our, if anybody's going to judge us, it's going to be ourselves. And who worse of a judge, you know what I mean? I think that most people would judge their self more harshly than anyone else. And But I look at it more like, if you've been in the business world, and so like if you've had a huge project, then you do a, at the end of that project, you come together as a team and you go, okay, what worked? What didn't work? What should we do? Should we make any changes? Should we tweak our program? Should we, you know what I mean? And so, it's really just a question of for your own soul's growth, I feel. But I don't really foresee that I'm going to be in any lineup waiting for God's approval that, I passed or I didn't pass in this lifetime. And then I quickly wanted to say is like, there comes that ending time, and my perfect story on that one is a friend of mine who, he went on his holidays. So he was also very, helpful to his employer, I guess, because in the way he died. Cause he did it on his holidays. And so he didn't miss a day's work, right? So he has this massive heart attack. And it just so happens that he was on the phone with his sister at the time, who lives further away from him and whatnot. And so as it turns out, she managed to make sure he could get to the hospital in time, and he had triple bypass surgery, and he survived that surgery, and then they sent him to a more of an extended care place or whatever for the rehab part of it, right? And so he's you know, in recovery and doing fine, and then all of a sudden he gets pneumonia. And so now they send him back over to the hospital because he's now got pneumonia, and so they get the pneumonia under control, and now he's beat the pneumonia too. And now he's back over at the extended care place, doing his final. And we're talking about, he's all like, oh, as soon as I get home, I can't, because I had just started my radio show and he had not heard my radio show yet. And because my radio show was going to be starting, and then he had a heart attack. So he never ever did get to come to my radio show. And so then he's recovering, and all of a sudden, just out of the blue, like that guy dies, and he died of a stomach infection that nobody even knew that he had.
Wow.
You know? So I'm going like all within that. So the heart attack didn't take him, the triple bypass didn't take him, the pneumonia didn't take him, but bingo, it was the stomach infection that wasn't even on the radar of a problem, right? And so to me, I felt somewhat comforted by that because it was just time to go. You know what I mean? He kept dodging the bullet and he got up to his last exit point and he had to go.
Yeah.
And so I feel like that, now he had four different possibilities of how he could have died, right? Let's say he died at home alone because of the heart attack, and he couldn't get to the phone to, oh, how tragic would that be, blah, blah, poor guy died alone, didn't have, nobody even knew, nobody could save him. And then, or he dies in surgery, you know, or he died, you know, and so as it turns out, it was the most ridiculous of all the things, and poof, he's gone, right? And so I actually took some comfort in that because I go, like, hey, no matter, like, if he would have survived the stomach infection, he would have stepped outside the hospital and a bus would, or a toilet seat would have fallen on his head. You know what I mean?
Right.
And again, it's all about,
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. Go ahead.
No, I was done.
No, it's all about how you see things, because we can look at it negatively, but you looked at it positively. You looked at, he had a full, rich life. You know, he had all these exit points, and, you know, he did go, you know, people could have said, oh my gosh, he died at home. How sad that is. But, you know, he died in a care facility. Some people could say that's sad too, that he didn't get to die at home with the loved ones or however he wanted to go, that sort of thing. So it's all about perspective, and it's all about how we're thinking, you know? It is about how our state of mind is, because in the sense that, you know, when my grandfather passed away, he actually had an aneurysm blow in his stomach, not in his head, in his stomach. And the ambulance wouldn't come in because he had a dog. So they had to wait for the police to come in. And so the family obviously was quite upset about that because they think that if they had gotten there, he would have passed. I mean, he's 82 years old. So the thing is that, you know, he, you know, made it through the surgery and they're telling everyone he's going to have extensive time in a care facility. And then they're shocked that he even made it through the surgery. And then they go back and he died. So my mother and I were talking about it and I said, Mom, Grampy's spirit was over there hearing what the doctor had to say. And he's like, I'm out of here. No way I'm going into a care facility. I'm done. And so when they came back, he's like, yeah, go ahead. I'm crossing to the other side. Take me. Was it his last exit? I don't know, kind of thing. But, it, you know, as you said, you had a positive perspective. Some people, when they have that negative perspective of someone passing away, they could be grieving for 5 years. They could be grieving for 10 years. And then that could really affect their lives. And is it,
well,
it's,
not that. I also believe that we affect the person that's crossed over when we hold to the grief for so long and so deeply. In the Aboriginal, in the Cree tradition, they say, like, when somebody dies, like, you can cry all you want and everything else, but on the third night after the third sunrise of the death, you are not to cry. And this is believed because that's when the soul is crossing and you don't want anything to be holding the soul. You know what I mean?
I actually have to agree with that. I mean, even though when my father died, I cried a heck of a lot more than 3 days. I mean, it was probably, you know, on and off for years, but and it's been 22 years now. Pardon?
Right. I mean, it's more the concept than any number. You know what I'm saying? And, but when I have somebody that's still 10 years later, so deeply entrenched in that grief, like, I always try to say to them, if that was you, would you be happy at all if you were on the other side watching your loved one be miserable for the next 10 years and be so deep in their grief that everything else is being left out? Of course not. And so we kind of owe it to our loved ones or those people that cross over that we don't also use that their death as some excuse or reason for our misery. You know what I mean? Like for us to fail or be miserable, because it's certainly not what they would want. And we want to honor, you know, theoretically, we want to honor our dead people, right? We don't want them to feel the burden of the burden of your ongoing misery now. You know what I mean?
Right, absolutely. And you see people who had a loved one pass away and they've, you know, moved on and remarried in 3 years. And some people have judgment about that. And oh my gosh, they should have waited longer or that. And it's different. Grief is different for everyone. But again, having grief for 10 years, I mean, that is not, how is that serving, as you said, the person who's having the grief, but it's also they're perpetuating. I mean, I'm not diminishing anyone who's had someone, a loss, you know, and someone passing, but how is that, if you're staying in that state of grief or that state of, I don't want to call it fear because when someone passes, you may be in fear because that person, you know, was your rock or that person helped you have that security. And again, we have to have that security within ourselves, you know, that sort of thing. Yeah. I remember my dad was my rock. I used to say he was the rock of Gibraltar, you know, kind of thing. And I felt like when he died, I was abandoned and, you know, all these things. But, you know, I had to realize that I had to look within myself and have that security and safety within me. He was a parent. And at the same time, I'm trying to remember where I was going with that train of thought. It comes back to the state of mind because I do believe as an intuitive and somebody who's a medium and who talked to spirits the other side, you know, as you said, and I do believe in that, when they go through the crossing, if they have someone this side who is deeply grieving them and is not letting them go, they have a hard time crossing over. And that's why we have all these hauntings. And there's two reasons why I believe that we have hauntings. One is because they're bound here because someone's grieving them and they can't let them go, right? Which is tough. The other one has to do with either that spirit is afraid to go to the other side. The person who just passed, they don't know what they're looking for or not looking for, but they don't know what they're walking into. And that can be very apprehensive, especially if you don't have someone crossing you over, you know, kind of thing. Cause you know, there's a time. who knows exactly what there is when you go to the other side. I just see it as the tunnel. And then what I see is kind of like a bus station of all these loved ones waiting for you on the other side. Sometimes people do actually get angels. I mean, again, this is my experience that I've seen, you know, so to speak, angels have some people cross over. Some people just go down the tunnel by themselves or whatever that looks like. Some people don't even remember it. They just wake up and there's a meadow. And then some people are in that negative state. So when they've had that experience, whether it's a near death, then it's a negative experience, so to speak. And it again comes back into a place of, you know, our mindset of what we're attracting and bringing in. Right. So on that segue of this person who was married three times, she had her mindset was, you know, she was a female led relationship, or she was a person who was very dominant, and she was kind of like an alpha, and she keeps attracting a beta, and she wanted an alpha male. She wanted someone who was an equal. You know, again, the thing that they talk about here in this book, she met a doctor, I believe, and obviously she's a receptionist, and there was a income difference, which that's not something she put in here, but he had talked about how she could break that negative pattern. This is when you believe that you can have the type of man you idealize, it's done as unto you believe. And it can be for the woman too. It doesn't matter what type of partner you want. The following specific prayer used to break the old subconscious pattern and to attract your ideal mate. So it's also about your thought patterns and your wording. And that's one of the things that we talked about. I mean, it affects everything, even crossing over, right? I mean, obviously, well, I can't say that I'm right or wrong about this, but, you know, obviously from what we've been talking about.
Well, I mean, and I think again that, you know, we see angels and we see, like, these are all ideas that we have in our subconscious about, I've said to people, like, who's to say that aliens or extraterrestrials, those that we would call extraterrestrials, aren't angels? And, you know, like, people get this idea in their mind of, like, the Bible descripted angels with great big wings and bright light, you know? But who's to say that that's that? That's just what the Bible says. You know what I mean? And so,
right.
So people get in their minds, these things that get entrenched, and that's like the people that are afraid to go, cross over because they think God's going to punish them, put them in hell to burn in all of eternity and everything else like that. So that there's a chance that they could get, you know, stuck earthbound. So listen, let's take a quick break. And there is a caller, whoever's called in, if you're calling to talk to Hillary, could you please press 1-1 right now on your phone so that I know that you're waiting to talk to us? Whoever telephoned in, wireless caller, okay, very good. Hi, Dan. I just outed you. It's Dan. He Skyped me. Okay, so that's good. So what if we take a break, and then we'll come back and we'll continue the discussion. Also, if anybody wants to talk to Hillary, feel free to activate your mic or call in. And I know that one of my chatters in the helpers in the chat room will be happy to pop in the phone number into the chat room there for you. So we're going to go ahead and take a quick song break, and then we'll come back and see where we go for the remainder of the show. And let's see, what will we play here? Let's do this.
Station.
Okay, I'm gonna do a quick one more song, a short one. It says Hillary got bumped off and she's still probably trying to connect. So here, let's do this one.
Thank you.
All right.
Are you looking for a place to meet like-minded people? Perhaps you're a light worker looking for a safe place to share your thoughts and services. We've got a place for you, IntuiTalks.com. Join for free, post updates, blogs, create and join groups via website or radio or class package. The possibilities are endless. Join the All Spiritual, All Under One Roof Network, www.IntuiTalks.com.
Visit purpleplates.com today. For over 40 years, the Purple Energy Plates have been delivering amazing results for their many customers. Inspired by the great genius Nikola Tesla, the harmony, healing, and energetic effects of the plates have proven over and over to be beneficial and often miraculous to thousands of customers. With their money-back guarantee and the many benefits, how can you afford not to get one? Check their site for daily specials and choose from their many energy products. You won't be sorry. Visit them today at purpleplates.com for mind, body, and spirit. And expect a miracle.
All right, we're back. Let's get this going before we drop Hillary again. And thanks, you guys, for hanging in there. A few people have dropped off, and we still have Carrie, Diane, Michael, Corrine, and our mystery wireless caller, who is, as we know, not mentioning any names at all, but his initials are Dan. Okay, and so let's go get Hillary back. Hi, Hillary.
Hi, how are you?
Good. Dan's been cracking me up on Skype on the side here, so I told him, stop it. stop. So we have about a half an hour, and why don't we bring it all home and with the summarize, because I always hijack your conversations on you. And so we've touched on a lot of these things, and in the beginning it was like the relationship thing, and it was like how our thoughts bring to us and things like that. And so if you want to like tie up all them loose ends that we've left, all them dangling ends, we can kind of come full circle with the conversation then and wrap things. Yeah.
Yeah. It's really more about the it's all that of what you said, and it's the power. Am I on, by the way? You guys can hear me?
Yeah.
Oh wow, it's so clear. It's just wonderful. It's the power. It's just really about power of thoughts and power of words. It's you have a seed, you plant the seed in the soil. The watering of that plant, so to speak, of that seed is really our thoughts, right? And then what happens is the plant comes up. And then what happens is we look for the serendipitous moments of the universe talking back and telling us certain things as we, you know, look about what direction we want to go, which is what you were talking about. It's not necessarily just the destination. It's really the journey as you go along, right? Having those experiences. So you're looking at the plant coming up and taking the opportunities to see what's coming to you. And then it's taking that harvest, which is taking that action. Really, kind of thing. But it's also, you know, it's releasing the fear. I'm not acting like all this stuff is just like poof easy. You can do it like, you know, flip of the finger sort of thing or a snap. It does take time. It does take practice and that sort of thing. But it's, consistency is really key. Right. And if we get that negative thought, we just cancel, and then coming back to having those positive thoughts in relation to, relationships and everything else, but go ahead.
And so we know that sometimes these thoughts that we have, like that they're the cause of us continuing to repeat unhealthy patterns and situations. And you of course mentioned earlier on that from time to time you've got, clients who are coming to you with these kinds of issues, whether it's in relationship to everything's a relationship. So whether it's like a personal love relationship or a family relationship or a job relationship, you know, these patterns of conduct, you know, that can affect our, you know, all of our key situations in life. And so how are you coaching people to break those cycles?
So what I do is usually in our first session, because everyone is different and we all have a different blueprint. And so, as I said, some people will say, well, you know, doesn't everyone feel this way? You know, isn't everyone having these kind of problems? Everyone's problems are unique to that person, right? And so what I do is I look at the first session as obstacles, lessons, and patterns. So to see what repeating pattern that person has, a lot of times it will go back to childhood. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it's later in life. That sort of thing about the seed that is no longer serving them, that thought process that no longer serves them. And so when we look at what obstacles holding them back, is that a fear? Is that something, you know, we can look at where are they hitting the wall, so to speak? And then the lesson is something that they're wanting to obviously learn, or an opportunity for growth. And then the pattern is something that's looping, something that is, you know what? Oh my gosh, the last three jobs I did do that. And it's related to this. So we look at, you know, childhood parents, you know, did the best they could with the resources and tools we have at the time. And needless to say, sometimes it's related to one parent or the other, or just a thought pattern of, this is how I felt, you know, when I was a child, or this is how I felt when I was older. And then looking at that thought that keeps repeating so that we can shift it, so to speak, because we have to identify it. Then they have to own it. And then I take, you know, the old programming pit by pit, and then we bring that new programming in. That's kind of how it works.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's having that consistent thought. I mean, like in relationships, it's, you know, a lot of times we harp on the negative about a certain person because if a woman's nagging, they're wanting time and attention that they're not getting because they're giving it to somebody else. Or, you know, they talk to, oh wow, they made a phone call to this person and they're texting this person. And, you know, they're talking to this person all the time and they're texting this person all the time. And, you know, they don't even acknowledge my existence or I'm alive. So you have to look at, you know, do they value that relationship? And are you valuing yourself being with somebody who really doesn't care about you or doesn't see the value within you? And then again, it may be, okay, well, energetically, they don't feel good around you. So how do you shift that energy so that you feel good around them and they feel good around you? And if you shift it, because again, it's a place of if someone's around you that's not, you know, you keep attracting people who don't see your worth or they don't see your value, then it comes back to you. Where are you not seeing your worth and your value? And then when you kind of reprogram yourself to see your worth and your value and you energetically magnetize yourself, these people around you that are not seeing your worth and value will either start seeing it or they'll shift out and other people will come in. And a lot of people, they say they want the change. I have said it too. And I understand this because one of the things is, especially when I was young, I did not like change. I didn't like it at all. I moved 16 times. You know, I can't remember I don't know for sure before I was 18. My dad was in the military. I've lived in Japan. You know, I've been so many different places and because my dad was a military brat. I was a military brat. So the thing is, I come into these places that everyone's known each other from kindergarten and they've all known each other. I'm the new kid on the block and I'm like, why should I set roots? Because I'm going to get ripped up and just the next month, next year, I'm going to have to move again. But see, because of my thought patterns, I didn't have a positive experience everywhere I went. I can't say that, but you know what I'm saying? I could have had a better experience. I could have had I could have had a much different experience than I did, but because I went in there and said, I can't enjoy the joy because I know the ending's coming and I know that there's going to be loss. I didn't allow myself to have joy. You know what I mean? And the thing is a lot of people, so what they do is they shut the heart down because they're like, I know a loss is coming. So they're afraid to bring the joy in and experience the joy because they're afraid of the loss, but loss is going to happen anyhow. And one of the things I realized when my children were older, they said, Mom, we don't want to move around so much. And I said, guys, let me explain something to you guys. I learned we could sit here and be in this house for 20 years, right? And you guys can go to the same schools and do this and do that. But I want you to understand that's not going to change the neighbor from moving. And that isn't going to change from, it isn't going to stop change from happening. Because one thing that's consistent in life is change. So.
Yeah. That's right.
So, So we, you know, it's how we roll with that change. That's why some people are comfortable with their box and they don't want much change. Change unnerves them. Some people love change and they thrive on it. And again, it's about knowing ourselves.
Well, and even that's just the reason why some people stay stuck in bad situations too, is because that's what they know and they feel more comfortable. It's not a pleasant thing, but they're afraid of anything else, I guess. And so, it's, you know, and it's hard to tell somebody who's doing that at the time that they're doing it, that, like, you know, you're kind of helping to keep yourself there, you know?
It's a hard one to hear, but it's true. I mean, even, you know, I see my own coaches, I see my own people that help me, you know, kind of thing, because I've got to do my personal work. I got to walk the talk and talk the talk so I can also help other people. And even though, yeah, I do this for a living and my coaches are calling me out on my stuff, I'm like, what? But you're right. You have to be called out on it sometimes to acknowledge, to see it, because we can't always see our own stuff. Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
So you're right. It is difficult.
Yeah, sometimes the change needs to happen, and as uncomfortable as it is, you know, like, I guess, like, if you have a pair of pants that's too tight, it starts to hurt more and more and then become impossible. But the point is like, you gotta change your pants. And change has to happen, you know, and sometimes, like, as I've said to many times, like, a lot of times, really what seems to be really awful things, you know, happening in my life have turned out to be the best thing that ever happened. You know what I mean? Cause it's what staged and set me up to be, at the next place and, for the next great thing that happened. And but for the other thing, I wouldn't have been there, you know?
Well, exactly. And so sometimes when we're going through the difficult part that we whine about, right? And we're upset, then all of a sudden we don't realize, as you said, it's there to set us up to the next place or the next lesson or the next opportunity, like you said, that you look at and say, wow, this is the best thing ever. And I would have never come here on my own if someone had said, you need to do this. And no, I'm not going to do that. No, you need to do this. So the universe kind of gives you a nudge, or they kind of push you a certain way, right? To say, here's your opportunity. Here's your opportunity.
Right. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I remember when I went to Hawaii, and I can't remember if it was 1982. I was 16 years old, and my mom had, you know, we all went to Hawaii, this beautiful island, and I complained. And I whined, and, you know, I'm like, I'm going to have so much homework when I come home. I mean, seriously, I complained I was going to have so much homework. Who cares about the homework? And I'm missing all these parties and, you know, all these different things, and I'm missing my life. But Hawaii was a once-in-a-life opportunity. I mean, I don't remember being back to Hawaii, and I'm 51. And, you know, I could have surfed when I was there. I could have done so much. And I think the last day or the second last day, I really – had a mind shift change about, wow, this place is so beautiful. Look at the beach. And I went into a positive state instead of a negative state. And I really started enjoying it, allowed myself to enjoy it. And it was time to go. And I took that time away from me. And even at 50, I have to keep my 51. I have to remember, you know, when something's so good and I'm enjoying it so much, and then you go into fear of, oh my God, I'm going to lose it. There's a difference between ego love and spiritual love, right? Because we go into the ego of conditional I want to control this, so to speak, or it has to be conditional instead of allowing it to be and having it serendipitously just unfold.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we want it to be the way we want it to be.
Yeah. Well, and then we hear people who say, like, why can't you just enjoy it? Because I'm waiting for the other shoe to drop. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because always, every time I have a good time, something always happens to, you know what I mean? And then there you go. There's that internal programming that again. And so never miss the moment. Never miss the moment. And one moment could turn into an hour, could turn into a day, a week, a month, and a lifetime, you know, if you let yourself, right?
If you, that's the whole key. If you let yourself, right? because, you know, it's the Marianne Williamson quote, which I don't have right next to me, so to speak. It's not our darkness that we're afraid of. Sometimes it's our light.
Yeah, that's right. I know when I first found any kind of a spiritual thing online or whatever, you know, all these, you know, foofy, unicorn kissing, lollipop sucking, you know, light workers, you know what I mean? All, oh, don't be, they're all afraid. And I'm all like, you guys are all denying that you have a shadow side. And you are, you know, so there, you're not ever going to be, that's not honest. You know what I mean? And I go like, I was a lot more comfortable with my dark side, a lot sooner than I ever, like I first became acquainted with my dark side. You know what I mean?
When you were young. Yeah.
Yeah. And so, I was all like, I felt a little bit like goofy with this light side stuff, you know? And, but you know what I mean? Like I go, I had it much easier than these people who live in denial that they have a shadow side and that they have a dark side. Everything's in balance. Everybody. And so when people talk about, oh, you people have to work on your shadow side. Like, you have to admit that you even have one, lady. You know what
right,
I mean? Whoever
right.
are that's listening to, and that it's not a bad thing. Like, we're meant to have that, guys. You know what I mean? Admit it, be able to identify it, understand it, and then that's the battle, is not to deny it and to lock it away and shut it down and everything else like that. You know? So, just be honest about it. If you guys come up across anybody that's all like, well, I don't have a shadow, I don't have this and that, they're lying. They're
right.
Afraid.
We all have a shadow side. We do.
They're being a fake. And so it means that they don't for them to even say that means that they don't understand their own spiritual path or who they are. They don't even understand, and they're trying to teach you. They're bilking you. You know what I mean? These are people that have really, for many, many, many cases, they've just really, they're taking other people's words and work and regurgitating it and being a puppet for it. And they don't even understand it themselves.
They're not in touch with their shadow side. So the thing is that we all have dark and light. I remember someone had said something to me and I, you know, being the person like, you said this and you said that, which is part of my makeup sometimes that causes a lot of problems, but I'm working on that. And he had said to me, Hillary, you have to understand that the world is a paradox, because if you don't figure that out, your life is going to be really hard. And so I said to him, well, if you're telling me that humans can be, you know, we're whole beings, right? And in humans' perfection is our imperfection. And as yeah. we're being imperfect, you know, cause no, that's being a perfect human is being imperfect. And I'm like, yeah. how is that possible? And he's like, it's a paradox, Hillary. But you said this and you said that. And it's not that I'm trying to be combative, which a lot of people think I am. But the thing is yeah. that I'm just trying to process all that of, well, wait a minute. That's one thing. And then how do we have another? And it's just, it's about, that's how we're whole. We're whole beings. And so again, he said, you know, if you have the light and you don't have the dark, how can you appreciate the light? You have to have that balance, right? Yeah. And as you said, the darkness sometimes, you know, there can be some positive things in that darkness, because sometimes you have to stand up for yourself. Sometimes you have to do certain things. You have to, well, I don't know. I don't know if we can say that there's positive out of that darkness, but, I guess the positive is seeing it and acknowledging it and working through it.
Well, and again, as I said the other day, and as I said in another way earlier today, is that, you know, with, like, we have these good and bad labels, right? We have these things, like, if there's an antagonist, doesn't mean they're bad, right? Like, it just means that, like, I talked to, you know, some people, and they happen to kind of share. It doesn't mean we're right, but I mean, is like, I go like, what if it's the most advanced souls and spirits who are the ones taking on these terribly hard roles to be the antagonist? Like, if that's the catalyst for change often, right? Is, you know, like the Hitlers, for example. You know what I mean? And so it's to say, like, did the world need to have that, right? To bring about some other, you know, some other change or understanding or whatever it is. And rather than burning in hell, you know, was Hitler just a really advanced soul who was, you know, who chose to take on just a really hard role, a really hard role. And not unlike being the bad guy in a movie, you know, the people we love to hate or whatever in entertainment. But so it's like these bad things, like again, when a bad thing happens, but yet a good thing comes of it, like, so that person that did that bad thing, like that boss that fired me back when I was like 18 years old or something, because I simply told them to F off. You know what I mean? But they did a bad thing to me, but it turned out to be a good thing, because if I would have stayed lingering there, I wouldn't have been at the other place, blah, 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 blah. So they go from instantly being a bad person to a good person because they actually helped me by doing that thing that at the time seemed to be a really bad thing, ultimately turned out to be a really good thing for me. You know what I mean? And so we shouldn't be like labeling good, bad until the final chat, till the end of the book, so to speak, right?
Right, right. Absolutely. You know, I mean, Oprah, I think, I don't know for sure if she was, I don't know if she left the job or if she got fired or something like that about, she was a broadcaster. And I think the gentleman looked at her and said, I just wanted to see about your head. And she goes, what do you mean? And he said, you're going to be a superstar or something like that. Right after she got let go from this position, or she just left the position, but she really wanted it. And she said that was a life defining moment for her, because if it hadn't happened, you know, she wouldn't have had, you know, obviously her Oprah show for the next 20 years, however long she had it. Yeah. So when we're in those despair, right, we're in this, like, this is the worst thing that could happen in our life and it's horrible. We don't know what's around the corner. It's looking at what that experience and the lesson is, or that sort of speak, so that we don't create the loop. But it is really important, as you said, to really look at our shadow sides, because if we don't ever look at that shadow side and just look in the and stay in fairyland, I mean, you know, positive affirmation is really important, obviously. Power of thought is really important. But, you know, things don't necessarily shift. I mean, that's part of the shifting. But to do that internal shift, we really do have to look at, you know, our behaviors and take responsibility for our behaviors, you know? And say, where is it positive for us, and where is it not so positive?
Right. Yeah, exactly. So, I don't know. We gotta try and get away from some of the label. Like, again, we put, like, who is it, Amy or somebody like that? Always like labels are for jars. You know what I mean?
Well, that's true, and I'm one of them. I used to label things all the time, and I had a friend who'd say, God, Hillary, why do you have to label everything? And I see both sides. One of it is that's something I was accustomed to and grew up. Doesn't mean it has to continue being that way, and it gave me safety and security of where the container was, or, you know, I would know exactly what that meant. But at the same time, too, then how are you allowed to grow and have freedom? How are you allowed to grow and be beyond that box that you've put yourself in? So, you know, now I'm getting older. I'm like, yeah, you know, our labels, what they're cracked up to be, or, you know, some people like labels to have that security. But again, it does sometimes inhibit that growth.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Yep, yep, yep. So, well, that's been a good conversation that we've had today, I think.
I think so, yeah.
So we got you back in early June. And what are we going to be having then?
So you're going to have me in June. We're going to talk about fear, because a lot of things, you know, we're talking about the power of thought and change and stuff. We get into that space of fear. And so I'm going to talk about that a little bit more, about how to come to a place of working through our fears.
Yeah, good. Okay. Tell people where they can find you.
They can find me at Ask Hillary Black, and Hillary is H-I-L-L-A-R-Y. So it's askhillaryblack.com.
Awesome. And on Facebook, they can just look up Hillary, Ask Hillary Black as well. Probably you got links to your other social media on your website.
Actually, I don't really have any social media other than that. Believe it or not, I have no social media. Everything I have is word of mouth.
So Facebook and your website.
What, Facebook and my website? I know I need to get a social media. I need to get that going. Yeah, I mean, your eyes almost popped out of your head, Chris. You're looking at me going, what? I know I'm not on the camera, but I can see you. And you're like, what?
Well, you know, I don't even use mine, so you know what I mean? Like, really, the only reason I use Facebook is to post a link 10 minutes before my show starts. And I barely do anything to my website. And so I'm no better. Okay, well, I'm looking forward to the fear discussion. I'm afraid of our fear discussion. The only thing that scares me is talking about fear. You have a good month and good rest of the spring and we'll see you back here next time.
Yes. Okay, guys. Thanks for having me again. All right. Have a good night.
Take it easy. Take care. And okay, now all the rest of you guys, I think we'll probably call it. I'm gonna toss a song on and then we'll come back and we'll wrap. I think we'll wrap unless you guys have it in your mind to do. To do overtime.
He rocked his way through yesterday. Lord, he thought he had a chance. He played guitar and wrote some tunes of love and romance. He did his share of traveling. Like a dog without a home, a fugitive who would rather give a star but never shone.
Isn't it pretty?
Isn't it a shame? No one ever won before. Rock and roll is a vicious game. Led around, or caught up in the games, or end up in a gallery of faces with no name. And rock and roll was in his soul, and music was a friend. He recorded a song that made us sing along, and he was on the road again. Isn't it a pity? Isn't it a shame? No one ever won before. Rock and roll is a big. His heart to us, he gave us what he could. We sympathized and harmonized. He made us all feel good. But it's funny how those things can change and time can pass us by. Songs can move us so easily, no longer make us die. Now, isn't it a pity? Isn't it a shame? No one ever wore before. Rock and roll is a vicious game.
All right. Okay. Let's see where we're at. So yeah, we'll call it a day. Tomorrow we have Diana's here. Tuesday we have Melissa Bruce, the heavy metal psychic. And so we'll call it a night for tonight. Thank you guys all, for being here. And we'll catch you back here next time. Oh, I have to get my silly quip page to work here now on me. And I've been watching the new Handmaid's Tale. Oh my God, what a crazy story that is. If you can find it online, watch it. Talk to you guys later. Peace out.